Welcome to Enjoy the Journey podcast, where we interview expert entrepreneurs and thought leaders to help guide you in pursuit of financial freedom. Presented to you by Jackson Milan, the Wealth Mentor, where we help service-based business owners remove cash flow bottlenecks, maximize their profits, and turn business profits into personal wealth. G'day guys, this is Jackson Milan, the Wealth Mentor, and we're here for another episode of the Enjoy the Journey podcast. A little bit of a hiatus as I've taken a bit of time off grid, but I'm super excited to be back and having a very special guest and a new friend of mine, David Inglis, all the way from Ontario, Canada. We got introduced actually on Clubhouse, one of the few very good things to come from Clubhouse. And then we connected through Taki Moore's Black Belt Group, and we've had some amazing conversations, some good partnership opportunities that have come up, and I'm really excited to share some of Dave's wisdom with you guys. So Dave, thanks for joining us, mate. How are you doing?
I'm doing just fantastic. It is a pleasure to be able to spend some time with you. And it's funny how we come to be able to meet, but at the end of the day, I think it's the continued connection that speaks volumes of some of the communities that we are privileged to be a part of. So thanks for having me join your group and talk about the journey that I've been on.
Right. It's a pleasure. So mate, tell us a little bit about you and what you do.
I'm the CEO of an organization called Threshold Leadership, and we teach leaders who have families how to use strategic solitude to make sure that they're not rich on paper and poor in life. In addition to that, one of the things that I pride myself around, and I would say the most important enterprise that I run, is my family. I'm a dad, I'm a new dad. I have a little guy named Will, who's about a year old right now. Two other great kids who are 13 and 11. It's funny, we decided to not have a third kid. And so we got a dog. And then all of a sudden, 2 weeks later, we found out that we were having a kid. So if ever you want to make God laugh, just tell him your plan. But that's what keeps me busy right now, is not only leading our organization and helping leaders navigate that complex intersection of growing a business and growing a family at the same time. I'm doing the work myself. In addition to that, I live here in Ontario, Canada, like you said, and I really am a student of life, and I'm happy to share some of the stories that I've been through and the experiences that have shaped to where I am today. But that's what I'm up to right now.
I love that, mate. Fantastic. I think the reason why I love what you do so much, Dave, is the unique spin that you put on this. I know that all entrepreneurs have heard of leadership, and particularly leadership coaching in business, right? We talk about these principles of most people get into business because they're great technicians and they need to become good leaders, great leaders, if they want to be successful in their business long term. But something that's not spoken about often enough, in my opinion, is how do you be a great leader at home? How do you be a great leader with your family? And how do you leverage those same skills and tools that you develop as an entrepreneur to be able to lead and create amazing outcomes in your household? So question for you, mate, where did you discover this realization of making sure that leaders have to be rich in the business, but also rich at home? Where did that come from?
Yeah. So, I mean, where it came from was me at a very young age in my first business that I had built, which was called Concussion Toolbox. So before I got into the work that we do now, I was in sports science, and I broke my neck and my back when I was 16 playing hockey. And as a result of that, I still loved sport. I wanted to be a part of it, but I couldn't necessarily do it physically, or at least at the elite level that I had aspirations to do. So long story short, we ended up building this organization called Concussion Toolbox. And after building it for about 3 or 4 years, I found myself in Hawaii, finally having an opportunity to be able to take a vacation. You know, you'd think you'd be being in a Maui, an amazing place. Truthfully, I found myself for the first time not able to distract myself with emails, distract myself with work, realizing that it was an empty victory. I had built this business, and here I am in one of the most beautiful places in the world, realizing that I'm embarrassed to go down to the beach because I'm 50 pounds overweight. My partner at the time, Kelsey, just left me because I wasn't there for her. And who am I to be able to say that the victory that I'm trying to build towards and leading this enterprise really has merit around it, really has that sense of success? And I, at a very young age, was, as my friend Philip McKernan has said, rich on paper, poor in life. It was that moment, the pain that I had personally experienced, that started to wake me up to that. Now, when you talk about being a really good leader, one of the big aha moments that I had, Jackson, was, you know, I spent a lot of time, and still do to this day, studying the idea of leadership. But when I really thought about leadership, I didn't necessarily understand truthfully who I was leading and who I wasn't. You know, I was with a group earlier today. We were running a retreat with business owners, and one of the first questions I asked them to do is make a list of all the people that you're leading. And as I sit there and I write it down, and then I really thoughtfully ask them, where are you on that list? Are you even on the list? And when you talk about leading at home, one of the things that I realized when I was in Hawaii, that yes, there's the quite literal definition of home, right? That I'm in right now, and the fact that we have kids and we have family members, and yes, leadership can exist in that landscape. What I realized in Hawaii was that the interior empire of myself, my home, where I lived every single day, I wasn't leading there. I wasn't practicing self leadership. So it was me really going through the motions of recognizing, wow, I've been so focused on leading others that the real cost of me building this wealth was realizing that I am absolutely poor in my health set. I am so poor in my relationships right now. To me, that was the catalyzing moment for me to realize the importance of what it looks like to be able to lead at home. And the irony of all of this was, for some quick context, I grew up in a family where my dad is a business owner. All he focused on was building his organization. And I told myself, I actually wrote my dad a letter saying I did not want to speak to him again because of how little he was participating at home. For 5 or 6 years, we never spoke. But I was in Hawaii. One of the big things that I walked away from, I was picking up the phone to apologize to him because I had turned into the very person that I said I wasn't going to be, all while trying to build that enterprise. So that's how I kind of came across it.
Right. That really resonates with me a lot. I think what's interesting, and I had a very similar journey where I've always found myself distracting myself with business or keeping myself busy. And what I discovered is it was a means of occupying my mind to the fear of being still and being in the constraints of my own head and having to work on myself. And I had a mindset coach who said to me, Jackson, if I tell you don't think of an elephant, what's the first thing that you think of? You think of an elephant, right? Yeah. And he explained this analogy of when you're riding a motorcycle, when you're turning into the corner, you look where you want to go. And if there's a tree that you don't want to crash into and you look at that tree, that's where you're going to start steering. And I think it's this thing of just by saying, I don't want to become that person. I don't want to be my father. I don't want to be my mother. I don't want to have the same experience. We actually set ourselves to start ending up on that path, as opposed to starting to talk about what I want to be, as opposed to what I don't want to be. For a really long time, I fell into this trap of referring to myself as a shark. I'm like a shark. If I stop moving, I die. And I had a friend of mine who pulled me up on it and said, oh, Jackson, listen to yourself. What does that mean? You're like a shark. If you stop moving, you die. And it was a way of just keeping myself distracted. It's really interesting. This last holiday that I've been on, Dave, was the first time that I could be completely still and out of the business and disconnected and present with my partner and our little fur baby family and not feel guilty. And I'm sure you can relate that it's so empowering and it's so refreshing to be able to have that freedom from yourself, to be able to be the architect of your own life and your own experience, right?
Most certainly. And when you have that, that's when you can build some really cool stuff, right? I often refer to that. And for people who haven't done the work, it can be painful going through that process. I think it's important work to do. But really, the journey that we're talking about, I've come to describe it as the homecoming of authenticity. Talk about leading at home. Well, there's a journey of homecoming. There's a journey of coming back home to honor and take action like you have, which are really tremendous expressions of loyalty to our real self. And when I say self, I don't mean the person, even who you and I are on the call here today with. I mean the one who, once we're done, once we hang up the phone, once we close the door, once you finally put the fishing rod on your hand and you're out in the river. So it's so important to go through that process of having a homecoming of your own authenticity. That's where I think we can really build not only really great businesses, but great businesses that are great in our context. Because sometimes, you and I both have been through this, I'm sure, you end up making decisions to build businesses that objectively do not make sense to build. But for you, if you can go through that process of understanding and being able to visit that internal sense of home and leading self really effectively, that's where you can start to bet against the consensus and win because you know it's right for you. But I think a lot of us take sometimes having empty victories that are triggering moments to say, I think there might be a better way of doing this. I might be missing out on something.
And I think so many people learn the hard way with this stuff, Dave, like they have failed relationships or their kids don't have that same level of connection to them that they thought that they once had, or they've lost other family and friends through sacrifice of their entrepreneurial pursuits. And this is why I really hate this whole hustle culture, this Gary Vee hustle movement of working 16, 18 hours a day and glorifying this workhorse mentality and this ultimate sacrifice for the greater scaling of a business, right? And that's not healthy. So, mate, in your experience, what are the biggest mistakes that entrepreneurs make that results in this lack of balance, this lack of this kind of triple bottom line that we've spoken about in the past?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest mistakes is that we attach our self-worth to our net worth. I'm going to say that again. We attach our self-worth to our net worth. And so when we do that, immediately when that's the primary design principle of how we are evaluating ourselves, how we're feeling legitimized, how we find ourselves being validated in a sense of belonging, we begin to design our life around that. You know, we've all heard this before, what gets measured gets done. So if we're measuring and evaluating our sense of self-worth, which is the quiet voice that speaks to us at the end of the day when we put our head on the pillow, our actions will always stem from what are the things that are going to allow me to elevate my self-worth. And like I said, if it's net worth, all of a sudden we're going to monomaniacally focus on the levers and the areas where we're going to be able to create tangible value. For some people, that means more profit, more growth in the business. For other people who are thinking about starting their own business, it could be a promotion. It could be some sort of third-party validation through awards, right? But again, by and large, it just continues to fuel the fire of focused on over-indexing time and energy on building a business. Now, you and I both know from being in an experience now where you can take a holistic approach to that, you actually end up building better things and performing better when you can lead from and build those things from a place of inspiration, of which taking a holistic approach to the way that you're thinking about your wealth can be really healthy and really contribute to that. But I would say that's the answer, right? Is we attach our self-worth to our net worth. That's a big problem.
I agree, mate, 100%. And I think it comes from experiences that we've typically observed. Like I know from my childhood, my parents were extremely hard workers, but they went through cycles of working extremely hard and not being present because that was the only way that they knew. They made money and they weren't available, or they were available, but we had to go without because they weren't earning the same amount of money. It's this scarcity approach, this shrink yourself wealthy principles where people feel like they have to choose either I have time, but I don't have money, or I have money and then I don't have time. So I think now that we're in this new world, like as entrepreneurs in this today's day and age, we have a lot more freedoms that maybe our parents didn't have. So how do we let go of these kind of past histories and experiences that we've come to accept as gospel and truth, and allow ourselves to create a new path where we can kind of have our cake and eat it too?
I'll tell you like a framework and a heuristic, a mental model of how I would invite leaders and entrepreneurs and business owners to think about it. And then if it's okay, I'll share with you a practice that I've come to have deep commitment to that's allowed me to stay aligned with that. Because making a change to get into a spot where you are a truth walker, you're doing the things that are right for you, right? And you're building a holistic approach to the way you're building that business, and you're not finding yourself in that kind of tension, push or pull, like you spoke to a moment ago, that's one part of the journey. Staying there is another, right? Another way to kind of put this is a very athletic way of thinking about this. There's rehab and then there's prehab, right? How do you rehabilitate yourself and bring yourself back to alignment? And then how do you use prehab? Proactively make sure that you are maintaining the alignment and the capacity that you need to be able to make sure that you're not operating from that place of scarcity where you're constantly trading time and money, okay? So as far as a framework and a heuristic around this, I shared this with you before, but for those who are listening, you know, there are fabulous organizations called B Corporations in the world. And if you haven't heard of them, they operate off a very interesting governance model where their success metrics is built off of something called a triple bottom line. In fact, where I came across this was on my flight home from Hawaii, because I remember being there, I'm like, wow, this sucks. Is there a better way to be able to do this? How do I lead myself? And what are models and examples that are already out there of holistic wealth? And when I started to research this about 7 or 8 years ago, or this, I guess, was back in 2013, so even maybe a little bit longer than that, started to realize, wow, B Corporations, this is a fantastic way of thinking about it. And their triple bottom line is profit, people, and planet. But in principle, what's really cool about a triple bottom line is that when you take a holistic lens to the way that you measure your success, and you acknowledge that in business, there are non-traditional currencies worth building wealth in, like your impact on the planet, your impact on your service to people. Wow, as a leader, don't you make different decisions? All of a sudden, it forces you and invites you to take a value-based approach to the way you're choosing the investments that you want to make to build wealth. And again, we're still going to attach our sense of wealth to our self-image, but what if we reframed wealth? And so to me, this idea of triple bottom line allows us to still kind of have our cake and eat it too, because when I think about a triple bottom line for myself, let's not kid ourselves. Personal wealth is the top of that line. Like that is a massive, I am continuously interested in looking for meaningful ways to be able to grow my wealth, 100%. But my triple bottom line, and what I would encourage others to reflect on, is my health set is one of them as well, and my relationships. If you want to continue to build your wealth and to amass a tremendous amount of it to be able to pass on to your kids or do really cool shit with, a big idea, live longer than your competitors. If you want to be able to amass your wealth, we both know this, the amount of time that your money is in the market is a huge influence on the amount of wealth that we have, right? And so live longer. for God's sakes. So invest in your health. That's a big one for me. Another one, my relationships. And my wife does a lot of really meaningful work. She's an expert in pediatric mental well-being. That's a big topic right now, right? When you think about COVID and what we're going through. And one of the things that she often reminds me of is this really interesting body of research that came out of Harvard Medicine School. A very long study. I think it was 60 or 70 years. I may be goofing up the specifics on this, but the point that I want to make is pure and real. It's quite simply this. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter how much wine you drink. It doesn't matter how many days of vacation you take every single year. As far as the long-term quality of life is, when the going gets tough, do you bring your relationships closer to you or do you push them away? And so it's having a lot of money is one thing. Being able to have the quality of life where you have posturing the opportunity to enjoy it is a whole other. And so that's why I think when it comes to wealth and having the health set to be able to play the game longer and relationships to be able to make sure that when the going gets tough, because I expect it to, that our moments in building business where it does, I will bring those people in closer to me to allow me to be resilient and to allow me to be able to overcome the challenge that I expect and the challenge that inevitably as a business owner, as an entrepreneur, you have signed up for. And so that's a mental model, Jackson. Before I kind of go on to how do you maintain that is this idea of a triple bottom line, but changing what those currencies are at a very much an individual level. And again, permission to make that your own. If health set and relationships don't necessarily click with you and there's a couple others, please make it your own. But the principle here is triple bottom line, taking a holistic look at your wealth. And when we do that, when we check in on that, when we think about the investments we're making and also the amount of wealth that we feel like we have in those areas, it really does galvanize and activate us to be able to lead a little bit differently. So how does that resonate with you? Is that something that, you know, when you think about your triple bottom line, is that a way that you would think about your wealth or this whole idea of kind of push and pull between time and money and trading that off? How do you feel like that triple bottom line heuristic or mental model supports that in your experience personally?
Yeah, I love that. I think our triple bottom line is profit, time, and wealth. And the reason why we look at profit is it's about the active income that you're producing. And I'm a big believer in creating a lifestyle business. And to me, a lifestyle business is a business that you could continue to work in until you're 80 or 90 years old. And I have no intention to retire. I hate the idea of having to sit around and watch daytime television or try and keep myself occupied, right? I love what I do. And over time, I'm sure that's going to evolve and I'll have other interests and passions and things that I want to pursue. But I want to be able to pursue those things because of fueled by my passion, not just in blind pursuit of money. And it's also just having that sustainable journey. And then the time piece for me is about having the ability to choose where I invest my time as opposed to spend it. You can invest the time in the quality of the relationships, like you've said. You can invest time in others of mentoring and giving back to the community. You can invest time in your hobbies and interests, because I think this is a big area, and I'm guilty of this too, Dave, is that through this idea of growing a business, many personal things go out the window. Hobbies, personal interests, all of these things often get sacrificed. And I know that when I have balance in those things and I have time to go fishing and I have time to do jiu-jitsu and do all of these things, like four-wheel drive and go overlanding, these things fill my cup and it makes it so much easier to come back and make profit. And then thirdly is wealth. And wealth is about having that passive income and that personal wealth where I've got freedom to choose the options and things that I do pursue. Because maybe there's one day I get out of bed and I don't want to ever have to work again. And I just want to be able to work my farm and be able to do things I'm passionate about without having to think about money. So that's my triple bottom line.
And again, in principle, right? It's a holistic look at the things that matter. And even the way that you describe that, you can see how, in the case of how even simple things like choosing to use language, like investments of your time, a lot of things like health set, like relationships, knowing me the way that I do, are natural outcomes of that, right? But for somebody who's maybe thinking about this for the first time and maybe is struggling to feel like they're building their enterprise at the cost of those things, and maybe quietly know that there's a part of themselves that the world doesn't see, I would, with all due respect, encourage them to start with relationships and health set. I feel like in your case, you've already gone through this journey, right? And you've done a lot of thinking here where you have a very mature way of thinking about that, where you're able to focus on profit, wealth, and time by also being mindful of those other things like your relationship and your health.
I fall down on these. Like, for giving an example, Dave, to be completely honest, I was having a conversation with my coach who's working with me to help continue to level up and lift the lid on myself. And something that has gone by the wayside is my fitness. Well, as we've been on the road and the instability of having a constant changing environment, my main way of being fit when I was back at home was jiu-jitsu. And finding gym, like new gyms, and being able to keep my uniform clean and do all of these things that goes into being a good jiu-jitsu practitioner is very difficult. So the threshold for me to pursue that activity is much higher and easier for me to procrastinate because it is higher. So I refer to BJ Fogg's book, Tiny Habits. We talk about that action threshold. That action threshold has now become far higher because of the difficulty of proceeding. So it's something that I need to work on to work out that my default action is actually taking action. So it's something that I'm working through. And I'm sure many people resonate that they hear a podcast like this or they listen to somebody like you speak and they go, wow, this is phenomenal. This is a great reminder. But then life gets in the way. So Dave, how do people keep this top of mind to ensure that they are conscious and that they are investing enough time and they're held to a certain standard that they can actually push the needle forwards on these things?
I'm happy to speak to that. And the one thing, as I introduced this, something I also want to be really clear on is sometimes there are different seasons in life and decisions that we've made where we're choosing to not actively invest as much as we normally would in our health set. As I explain this practice in a moment here around something called strategic solitude that we teach, there's a big difference between borrowing and stealing. You're on a beautiful trip right now. You're choosing to travel your country with your partner, a loved one, and have a remarkable experience. There's a finite period of time there where you're going to be on the road. And who knows? Maybe, you know, all of us listen, you could be on the road for the rest of your life. Who do you know? But jokes aside, there's a conscious choice that I'm going to borrow a little bit of time and energy away from my health debt because I'm going to double down on my relationship and having moments of adventure and awe right now. Cool. That's awesome. But a lot of us steal. A lot of us don't have explicit conversations or decisions around that. I have a friend who is building a remarkable commercial real estate business here in Canada. A big aha he had around this conversation of stealing versus borrowing was, wow, I've been stealing time away from my kids because I've been continuing to prioritize work for the last 6 years. And I continue to say that next quarter, it'll get better. Rather than saying, hey, for the next year, I need to borrow a little extra time to be able to go and build this part of the business. And then I'm going to return and pay back that time by maybe having a cycle or a quarter or two where I can now shift those priorities and then maybe make a different choice. But again, there's a big difference between borrowing and stealing. It's that explicit communication. I think a lot of us are stealing when you think about these other currencies. I mean, again, borrowing means that there's an agreement. It means that sometimes we have to renegotiate our financing. That's okay too, but it means there is an agreement. There is a conversation there. So I digress. What I would love to share though is how do we make sure that we are staying aligned in these areas and we are continuously recalibrating the investments that matter to us to make sure that we stay focused on the right things and ultimately find ourselves in being high-performing business owners, but also highly fulfilled at the same time. Those two things can coexist. Kind of tying back into my story, right? To home from Hawaii, and I realized, wow, this was a wonderful vacation. Wouldn't it be nice if I could go and do a vacation and not feel miserable getting on the flight coming home from this? What if this was strategic? And I started to reflect on my business and saying, wow, you know, every quarter, every year, I spend a lot of time and energy taking my team members away, and we plan for the business. We want to make sure the business continues to grow. We want to make sure we're still focusing on strategy and working on the right things at the right time. Cool. We think about black belt, right? We have intensives. We invest in 3 times a year, taking ourselves aside as business owners to make sure we're looking at how we're progressing, what our rhythm looks like, where are we winning? What's the next right thing to be able to go and do? We do this all the time in business. So I started to ask myself, what might that look like personally? And I came to a really thoughtful practice that I've committed to for the last 7 or 8 years called strategic solitude. Every 90 days, I prearrange a full day for myself where I go away on my own. And in that space, I'm asking myself some really thoughtful questions. Where am I clear right now? Where am I unclear? What values of mine am I really stepping into right now? Where is my audio not matching my video? What am I leading from a place of strength? Where do I feel vulnerable, anxious, and maybe a little bit weak right now? I go away with some of these simple questions to be able to sit with and kind of check in. I evaluate my triple bottom line. And I look at my last 90 days and say, what investments have I been making? Which ones are no longer serving me? And I go and do this entirely on my own. Now, the interesting thing is yeah, you know, these are really thoughtful questions. And some people listening might say, hey, this makes sense. Yeah, I'd love to be able to go and do that. But here's the reality. Here's what I've seen. And I've seen it in leaders that we coach. I've seen it in myself. It's super easy when you're running a business to have a lot of damn good excuses to not go and take that full day for yourself. And all of a sudden things slip and we don't go and do that. You know, I was bumping into a couple of ours down the road here. I think everybody during COVID took up the professional sport of walking. And so we were out for a walk, we were talking to our neighbors and we bumped into them and they were celebrating their 10-year anniversary. I said, that's amazing, guys. Now, let me ask you, have you guys been married for 10 years or 1 year repeated 10 times? And so it's easy when we skip these moments of strategic solitude, where 1 year goes by, 2 years goes by, 3 years go by. And unfortunately, when we start to drift like that and we do not evaluate our experience, it requires pain to get to a 9 out of 10 or a 10 out of 10, much like me in Hawaii, to be able to create the degree of awareness that we need to go and make some of those changes. My wish for all of you leading is that you don't have to wait for those types of moments. So strategic solitude, how do you make sure that you actually follow through on it? Here's a really important piece. You have to incentivize yourself as a business owner and entrepreneur to go and take the space by building the space of strategic solitude around adventure and awe. For me, I'll give you a really quick example. And then Jackson, after I share this, I want you to maybe share with us what a strategic solitude day might look like for you under this thinking. Every 90 days, there's a beautiful place here in Ontario called the Alora Mill. It's my favorite hotel. I love it. There's 5-star service, remarkable staff. There's also a great creek and river right there where I can go fly fishing. And so when I think about this, there's a great saunas on site. There's all the things that I love to go and do. There's great parks. There's great nature. I can bring my dog Mango. And so I go to the Alora Mill and I always make sure I move mountains and protect that space, because the first 2 hours of my day are adventure and awe that I finally get to go away by myself to go fly fishing in my favorite part in the world and have an amazing meal. Like, I would go and move mountains for that. And so each of us, what is that adventure and awe experience? What is the thing that will incentivize us to say, no, I'm going to cancel that meeting. No, this meeting does not get moved. I need to make sure I'm going to go and follow through. Because here's the interesting thing. I talked a moment ago at the beginning of this conversation about the homecoming of authenticity. What does it feel like? And you're in the most beautiful hotel that you love. You go into the river. You go fly fishing for 2 or 3 hours. You come back. You have a great lunch. You're home. It's a process of homecoming. To me, I use that adventure and awe as a way for moving aside my emails, even allowing my family to be able to be at home and kind of just insulate myself. But all of a sudden now, through the process of adventure and awe, through the process of creating a moment that's so exciting for myself that I would absolutely fall through, now when lunchtime comes, I'm set up to answer those questions with a tremendous amount of authenticity. My real true self can start to emerge. And that's where I can start to answer these questions in a very vulnerable way, where the insights and the ahas from that allow me to be able to begin again every 90 days around that. So that's the practice, right? Is this combination of adventure and awe that incentivizes us to take strategic solitude. And when we're there, by continuing to do this consistently, but every 3 months, every 6 months, and having to practice around that, we can always come home. We can always go through that journey of coming home and having the awareness we need to make better choices and ultimately build better results in the way that matters to us across that triple bottom line. Does that make sense?
I love that, mate. That's phenomenal. We had a very similar experience in this month that we had away heading up to Cape York. And for those of you who don't know, Cape York is one of the remotest parts of Australia. It's literally about 14 hours of corrugated gravel roads, and we then went to go do a really notorious piece of four-wheel drive track called the Old Telegraph Track, which is basically on any four-wheel driver's list, bucket list of four-wheel drive tracks. And for those 2 days or 3 days that we were on the Old Telegraph Track, there's no reception. You're basically completely disconnected. You're in some of the harshest environments in the world. And that was the adventure and awe that I needed to then be able to look at my business, look at my life, look at my relationships in a completely different light and reevaluate what is really important. That really resonates with me.
I mean, and everybody's different, right? Like the idea of going fly fishing near a hotel or going on your four tracks and going on the adventure that you went on, some people might be listening to that and be like, that's the last thing that I want to go and do. One of the members in one of our last intensives was sharing with me, like, for him, racing a car, going to the racetrack. So here's the key thing. Here's how you want to make it easier to be able to follow through than not. I'll share a quick story around this. And for those listening, I want you to write down the acronym FOS, Forced Optimization Strategy. How do we apply a strategy where the easier to follow through in the things we want to go and do for ourselves, like strategic solitude, that's a prehab thing. Pain doesn't trigger it, but we know it's really good for us. It's easier to follow through than not. Quick story on this, and then I'll kind of tie back into strategic solitude. We did Ironman races a number of years, and I would wait for my legs to be on fire before I would call a massage therapist. I would literally wait till I could like not walk anymore to be like, Dale, can you take me in? Can you squeeze me in like now, like this afternoon? And every single time he would laugh at me on the phone, be like, David, why do you always wait until you need it? And so what does the force optimization strategy look like? sit down with Dale. Say, okay, well, it makes sense to me. Proactively, every 2 weeks, I should be here to see you. Let's schedule a massage every 2 weeks for the next 52 weeks. I'm going to give you my credit card. I'm going to prepay for them. That way, it's easier for me to fall through than to not. And this is something I know that's really healthy for me. So strategic solitude. I know it's really important for me to leave my family and to build a great enterprise at home and a great business for me to take the space that I know I need. I have lots of excuses not to, 100%. How do I apply force optimization strategy to make the default following through? I call the Alora Mill. I have my favorite hotel room booked out every single 3 months for the next 2 years. It's in my calendar. I've prepaid for it. I have my fly fishing guides already prearranged and scheduled. I can always cancel these. Shit comes up. I got set up my kids. I can go and cancel if I need to, but I'm set up to not. I have to put in energy and effort to cancel it rather than putting energy and effort in to make it happen. And so it's about understanding what are the things we want to do in a very proactive prehab basis and then installing the system before we need it. So that, again, the default is follow through. Okay. Does that make sense?
It really does, mate. And we had a conversation a while back and I took some of your advice and I reevaluated my triple bottom line around the things of looking after myself better, both from an eating standpoint and also from an exercise standpoint. So as soon as we're in our new house, which we're in the process of hopefully finalizing over the next kind of 4 to 6 weeks, the two things that are on my list to ensure that the default action is action is getting a personal chef who is going to cook nutritious meals for us every single week without us having to do it, and also to have a personal trainer and a private jiu-jitsu instructor come to my house every single week. Just simple.
It needs to be simple, right? And it just, you mentioned this earlier, the action threshold, it drops it down to be at your ankles rather than being a foot above your head.
That's
right?
It.
So these are all things that when we identify what these things are, when we have the space, all of a sudden, you know, this is a metaphor that I often use. In the day-to-day, you know, of working, of living and leading, it's kind of like having a boiling pot of water with rice in it. The burner's on 10 out of 10, the water is boiling, and the rice is just bouncing around everywhere. It's sometimes hard to discern simple, big, easy things like this that we can go and do that you just mentioned. Strategic solitude. You turn off the burner. You let the water settle. The rice settles. All of a sudden, with a pair of chopsticks, you can pick out grain by grain. There's clarity. Right? But if I was to ask you to do that while the boiling pot of water was there, you're going to burn yourself. Shit, right? And God knows you're not going to get a piece of rice either. And you're going to be frustrated in trying to do it. So strategic solitude is a matter of turning off the heat, allowing the water to calm down through adventure and awe. And when that's done, the rice is on the bottom. And all of a sudden, we have the discernment to be able to either check in to make sure we're leading the right way. And if that's the outcome we get, that we're doing the right thing, amazing, keep on going. But what if you're off a little bit? What if you're forgetting something? What if there's something you can do that eases and simplifies your life a little bit? Tremendous value that's available to those who take that space.
That's amazing, mate. This has been super insightful. Every time we speak, I guess the great thing about you, Dave, is that you've got a way of explaining these things. Many of us understand the theory, right? And we go, yeah, that's a good idea. But it's the analogies, it's the experiences, it's the way that you help people visualize and create those new synapses and pathways that help them really push the needle forwards is the greatest thing about you, mate. So I'm super grateful for your experience. So Dave, let's talk a little bit about your ideal client. So obviously you help people in implementing these principles and strategies to be able to define their triple bottom line and see them through to fruition through this concept of strategic solitude. So who is an ideal client for you?
I would say the ideal client, and this is a way that I, like nomenclature that I built to describe this, but the ideal client that I have is the aspiring eclectic millionaire. The eclectic millionaire, right? It's somebody who understands that wealth is a big ingredient to building and designing a tremendous lived experience, but they want to do it in a very eclectic way. They want to do it in a way that's unique to them. I think one of the things that I've often seen as an ideal client is that they understand the value of having these systems and these deliberately practices inside of their organization. Some of people might be familiar with something like EOS, right? Maybe you've heard of that practice, right? EOS, Entrepreneurs Organization or Operating System, I think it's called. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. I just am very familiar with the acronym EOS. And again, that's a system of operating your business. What we really teach leaders and what we guide them through is building a system of living. System of self-leadership. And so a leader who understands and has had tremendous value in their business and are ready to be able to apply that to themselves are looking for a way to be able to translate that into their own realm. Maybe they're going through and crossing a really big threshold. Our ideal perfect client for us, where all of a sudden when they look across the frontier, they realize that the stakes are getting higher. Maybe you have a kid who's joined your family soon. Maybe you're about to build a big business. Maybe you're about to get married. Maybe there's a big moment coming in front of you where you want to make sure you don't lose what you have. You want to make sure that you are very intentional and proactive in building the right type of wealth as you're moving forward. And so I kind of, like I said earlier, articulate this as the eclectic millionaire as a way for thinking about that. So if there's a part of you inside where you feel like maybe the world hasn't seen it yet, or you haven't found a way to be able to integrate that into your leadership, reach out to us. I mean, we're happy to guide leaders through this meaningful process. And the cool thing is, and what I always really invite pause around is, when we go through this type of work, I always ask the question, what can you teach somebody else now as a result of going through this? Because at the end of the day, I think one of the coolest things, many of us have an opportunity to break an intergenerational cycle. And when we do the work ourselves, we all of a sudden can pass it on to others, either quite literally in our family, but I think we also build a really interesting family by the people that we meet, the people that we build businesses with, the communities that we serve along the way. So that's the kind of summary, if you will, Jackson, around the ideal perfect client for us. Maybe the kind of want or desire that they're after, that would be a good indicator that the work that we do is right for them.
Amazing, mate. Phenomenal. And if anybody's listened to this or watched this and they love what you've had to say and they want to get in touch, what's the best way for them to reach you?
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is we have this idea of a triple bottom line built into a really fun workbook. So I'll give it to you to be able to have in the show notes. If people want to be able to download that, that's a great way to be able to get in touch with us. But otherwise, thresholdleadership.co is our website and the way that you can get in touch with us. And I'm on Instagram at Dave_Inglis, I-N-G-L-I-S, if you want to be able to connect with us directly. But like I said, I'll send it over to you to have in the show notes. It's a great way to be able to take me into what we've had an awesome conversation about and just to start to do some of the work yourself, okay?
Amazing, mate. I'm so grateful for your time. I always love chatting to you, mate, because I always learn some great new things. And guys, if anything we've spoken about today resonates with you, make sure you take action. These are things that you need to implement, because a good idea in theory remains just that, a good idea, unless you put it into play. So Dave, thanks again for making the time, and I look forward to catching up again with you soon.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.